F delta P is equal to F, the electric force, times the cosine of phi. So we're going to go ahead and take this equation and plug that in. So plugging that in, this is what we've got so far. Now is that we've got the integral over time variable, but the thing that changes is R and phi are the things that change as we go through the scattering, but we've got a time variable, so we got to get rid of the time variable. Here's where we get, I don't know about tricky, but you know, something which you might not have thought of, but Rutherford is a Nobel Prize winning physicist, I believe, and he thought of, is that angular momentum is conserved, and we can use angular momentum conservation throughout, maybe we would have thought of this if we really thought hard. Maybe it's not a Nobel Prize winning thought, but anyway, angular momentum is conserved and we can use that. Remember, this is the definition of angular momentum. If we write it in terms of angular variables, it's I omega in the omega hat direction. If we write it in terms of our translational variables, our linear variables, it's R cross P. So that's the definition of angular momentum. And the fact that it's conserved means that Li, the initial angular momentum, equals Lf, before and after the scattering operation happens. So therefore, we can write I omega. This is a point particle. So I is mr squared. That's the moment of inertia for a point particle. Omega is d phi dt. Aha, now we're relating phi to time. Omega is just d phi dt. And that is equal to R times P, which is BMV. Where does the BMV come from? Well, remember that the angular momentum, R cross P, is equal to R perpendicular. That R cross P means, whoops, hold on. That's what R cross P is in magnitude. It's R perpendicular to P times the magnitude of P, and R perpendicular is just B, the impact parameter. So again, looking at that picture, is that we're looking at the initial momentum in that direction, and it's got R perpendicular of B. Okay. That's the initial momentum, but the momentum is conserved. So that's the momentum everywhere. Since that's the initial angular momentum, it's the angular momentum everywhere. That's just saying that's the initial angular momentum, but since it's conserved, we can set it equal to momentum everywhere, and therefore we can just do a plug-in. Now we can solve for dt in order to put that into the integral, and dt is equal to mr squared d phi over b mv. And the m's cancel, and we plug that now into the integral, and we get, so I just went ahead and pulled the constants out of that integral, and oh, look at that, the r's cancel, oh yay, because that, it would have been hard to do that integral, and now it's a super easy integral. Holy moly, that gets so easy. This is what we get so far. Okay, now let's just look at this equation real quick, and remember that v has to do with the velocity that we send the particle in at, and that shows up in two places. B is an unknown and theta is an unknown. Those are the parameters of the problem. B is a function of theta. M is the mass of the incoming particle. Z1, Z2 is the charges of our scatterer and scatteree, and everything else is a constant. And so now in order to get B as a function of theta, we just need to evaluate this integral. In order to evaluate the integral, we need to know what phi I and phi f are, and actually that's not so hard either. So remember, we've got the thing that's being scattered is coming in along the p initial axis, and it's being scattered along an axis which we'll call the p final axis. The scatterer cuts that axis symmetrically, and the phi variable has to do with the fact that at some point the thing being scattered notices the scatterer, so that would be phi initial. And at some point it stops noticing it and it stops affecting it, that would be phi final. But in reality, it should notice it from infinitely far away. So really, phi initial is this angle, phi initial is actually this angle, and phi final is actually this angle here, which are just, let's not, right? Don't get too confused, because this is theta. And so phi initial plus phi final plus theta must equal 180 degrees. So from that, we can figure out phi initial and phi initial must equal phi final. So therefore, we know that phi initial and phi final are 100, or pi minus theta divided by 2 equals phi initial equals phi final. And we can then do the integral and get an answer in terms of theta. So you know how to integrate cosine. It's just a sine. And then we're going to just go ahead and plug in, and I'll jump to the end because now it's just algebra and knowing your cosines and sines. So our v, we have two v's giving us a v squared. We had an m, and 8 over 2 is 4. So you can see that that 8, I just multiply 1 by 2 so that we can see that this is the kinetic energy of the incoming particle. Written cosine, but I meant cotangent is what you end up getting. Cotangent theta over 2. So this is the impact parameter as a function of theta. So what, again, what Rutherford is measuring is theta for the various particles, which he knows everything else here, and therefore he can figure out B, the distance of closest approach, for each particle that he sees scattering from the scatterer. As a reminder, his experiment basically is this simple. He's got a source of alpha particles, and he's got a target, gold foil or any aluminum foil or any kind of foil. And then he's got a detector, a scintillator, something that lights up whenever an alpha particle hits it. And so he can see those angles, right? The angle of scatter from the original line all the way around in a circle.